Whoever wanted to learn Greek in the ancient world did so by practicing Homer's work, where writers would imitate the prose, what is called mimesis, until they were proficient enough at writing in Greek. The most sophisticated literary mimesis was rivalry, or emulatio, where authors would exploit the works in subtle ways to communicate a point better than the original script. Now, Dennis MacDonald believes that Mark used a means called transvaluation to take themes from the narrative of the Odyssey and the Iliad and present a new story about a messianic king, Jesus of Nazareth. The strongest parallels, however, are those between Odysseus and Jesus. Homeric tales about Odysseus emphasize his suffering life, just as in Mark, Jesus said that he too would suffer greatly. Odysseus is a carpenter like Jesus, and he wants to return to his home, just as Jesus wants to be welcomed in his native home, and later to God's home in Jerusalem. Odysseus is plagued with unfaithful and dim-witted companions who display tragic flaws. They stupidly open a magic bag of wind while Odysseus sleeps, and release terrible tempests which prevent the return home. These sailors are comparable to the disciples who disbelieve Jesus, ask foolish questions, and show general ignorance about everything. Eventually, Odysseus can return home, but he must do so alone and only in disguise, as if he were the object of a messianic secret. He finds his house taken over by greedy suitors for his wife. Odysseus remains disguised, but once fully revealed, he does battle, recovers his house, and lives a long and prosperous life. All of this is remarkably similar to the trials and tribulations which Jesus has to endure. Jesus, however, was superior to Odysseus in that he was killed by his rivals, but rose from the dead, took his place at God's side, and will eventually judge everyone. Historically, the idea of Mark's Gospels being a complete fiction based on Homer's writings is untenable. Mark using a prior narrative as a structural template of sorts to help charge the story of Jesus into the popular culture might have been a strategy Mark employed, in much the same way Paul used the unknown God of the Athenians to spread the gospel. The Spirit of God is freedom. Creation can be used to express truth. There is some truth in Aesop's fables, Pinocchio, The Lord of the Rings, and The Odyssey. A story doesn't have to be factual to express truth. Jesus often spoke in parables, mere stories, that were designed to communicate larger and more profound truths than the tales themselves. I'm not saying we should exchange our Bibles for the Twilight Saga. The profundity of the Bible as a work of literature is beyond comparison. But I am advocating that we become sensitive to God's Spirit, that we might embrace all truth. Doubts about Jesus' existence are still occasionally raised by those engaged in polemics against theology rather than participation in academic history. But it is not regarded as a serious line of inquiry in the secular historical study of the man from Nazareth. One searches in vain for articles in peer-reviewed literature questioning Jesus' existence, because any such attempt would involve an attack on historical knowledge itself. If we know anything about anyone from the ancient world, we know that Jesus lived and died in first century Palestine. Professors Gerd Thesion and Annette Mers of University of Heidelberg in Germany, leading critical scholars by no means advocates of Christian apologetics, but authors of thorough academic analysis, write, "The mention of Jesus in ancient historians allayed doubt about his historicity. The notices about Jesus in Jewish and pagan sources indicate that in antiquity the historicity of Jesus was taken for granted, and rightly so." The fact is, mainstream experts overwhelmingly agree that the core of the gospel narrative is historically sound. Let me bear this out with a famous quotation. Anyone acquainted with the historical Jesus studies will know the name of Ed Parish Sanders, a long-time professor at Duke University and, in everyone's estimation, one of the most important scholars of the last 30 years. He is no friend of traditional Christianity, but his statement of what can be known about Jesus from a historical analysis of the Gospels has stood the test of time. There are no substantial doubts about the general course of Jesus' life, when and where he lived, approximately when and where he died, and the sort of thing he did during his public activity. I shall first offer a list of statements about Jesus that meet two standards. They are almost beyond dispute, and they belong to the framework of his life, and especially of his public career. Jesus was born 4 BC, near the time of the death of Herod the Great. He spent his childhood and early adult years in Nazareth, a Galilean village. He was baptized by John the Baptist. He called disciples. He taught in the towns, villages, and countryside of Galilee, apparently not the cities. He preached the kingdom of God. About the year 30, he went to Jerusalem for Passover. He created a disturbance in the temple area. He had a final meal with his disciples. He was arrested and interrogated by Jewish authorities, specifically the high priests. He was executed on the orders of the Roman prefect, Pontius Pilate. We may add here a short list of equally secure facts about the aftermath of Jesus' life. His disciples fled. They saw him, in what sense is not certain, after his death. As a consequence, they believed that he would return to found the kingdom, and formed a community to await his return, and sought to win others to faith in him as God's Messiah. There was once a young man named William, the son of a steelworker, who grew in favour with those around him. He had 12 close friends, but as time progressed, he was bullied by his peers. He fought back. He flipped over chairs in the head teacher's office when he sensed injustice. One night, in the countryside in the dark, he was betrayed by one of his friends. Those around William thought he had died when they saw his motionless body, but he made a full recovery. The friend who betrayed William made himself scarce, but William forgave and loved his friends and reunited with them until the time came for them to go out into the world. I am William, and the point I want to make is that parallelisms are not uncommon in human experience. There are friendships, betrayals, wonderful times, terrible times, and amazing spectacles. I remember listening to a Jesus denier, Dr. Carrier, who considers Jesus to be a mere shadow of Elijah and Moses. Elijah met a widow, and Moses led people to freedom. Jesus doing the same evidences his mythology, reasons Dr. Carrier. But I, William Taylor, have met many widows and have freed many princesses. The fact is, strong parallels exist between people. Even made-up people who are ultimately imbued with true characteristics. People share experiences over long distances. I have friends on here who I have never met, whose experience so resemble my own that it's scary. Similar social experiences, employment by the exact same company, and yet we're both real people traversing the real world. You do not make a journey to faith in a vacuum. You do it with all your own baggage, your own preferences, your own strengths and weaknesses, and your own desires. History provides a strong indication that the Jesus story is believable, but Christian faith is a richer and more complex thing than mere believability. It's the prayer of Christ that we'll all conform to his lifestyle. that will be together in the one Spirit of God. And I pray that we all experience that. Let us revere God and be excellent to one another. All the best.